How you doing, Ben?
Yeah, pretty good. Thanks for coming on the call.
Yeah, nice one. Yeah, man, cheers for having me.
So,
It's
I
weird
don't
to finally chat, man. We've been Facebook friends how long? Since
Well,
the Free Man on the Land days and all that, anyway.
yeah, I
Long
think
time.
so. That's probably when it is. Must have been, I was doing that kind of thing around about 2010, 2011, somewhere around there.
Yeah, that's about around roughly when I was checking out all that stuff.
So I don't know where we're going to begin. I mean, I'd love to hear about your music and stuff, and I guess somewhere along the line we're going to end up talking politics. I don't know. But what you been
No
up to
doubt.
recently?
There's always music I'm working on. I've always got a new album coming out. Like every time someone asks me, like, "What are you up to musically?" I'm like, it's constantly the same response. I'm still working on it. I'm working on an album called Language in Practice, which is
Okay.
like as well as just me, practicing writing and writing lyrics and what have you. It's also like a free speech thing, if
What
you
do you
will.
mean?
Exercising my use of language and practicing the speech and stringing words together.
When you say free speech, do you mean it's got political themes, or is that what you mean?
Yeah, it's got political, not even just political, but a lot of the stuff, that you're not supposed to say, the stuff everyone thinks that you shouldn't say. I'm going at a lot of that.
Right. Let's expand on that a little bit.
More
So
so, more so controversial ideas than necessarily political.
okay.
But yeah.
Do you want to give us an example?
I just finished a tune called "Shut Up," which is the second song that's finished that's going to be on it.
Okay.
That's everywhere. That's on YouTube and all that. If people want to check it out, they can. I'm trying to think of a specific example. I can't think of a bring a specific lyric to mind.
I mean, just some of the topics you cover, I'm curious about,
Well,
as a bit.
exactly. Most things that I say tend to piss people off, or at least I feel that way. And it's kind of a, what do you do? Do you say nothing and shut up, or do you say it all, embrace it, and make the most of it, and seek the good?
Yeah,
I've opted for the latter.
trying to find that balance of whether to dilute your own ideas in order for it to be more palatable to more people, or whether to say what you
Yeah.
really think at the risk of losing some people. That feels like a kind of constant battle sometimes. I mean, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, totally. I think that's, in some ways, that's universal. I think that feeling. Like, I don't think anybody is, completely just like unfiltered all the time. I don't think anyone could, I don't think that's practical.
So there has to be some degree of restraint. Is that what you're saying?
Restraint, yeah. And it's, I suppose, the way you frame things in different settings and with different people, I suppose it's who you're talking to has to be taken into account. There's the way you describe the horrors of the monarchy, say, or 9/11 or something to a 5-year-old wouldn't be the same as you describe it to a friend. That's a silly example.
Yeah.
Nonetheless, it's an example.
Yeah, right. So you've got to tailor your message to your audience depending on the context. Is that what you mean?
Yeah, I think you have to. For it to be effective, you have to tailor your message to the audience. And that can be difficult, I think, when you're sort of doing stuff online or, say, writing songs, because I don't think there's any specific audience. Sort of the aim is just whoever wants to hear it, if you know what I mean. And
Yeah.
so you kind of just tend to, it's either just don't, either post nothing or go for it, sort of thing.
I'm curious how you, because you're in an artistic world, I guess, being a musician and being in a band and surrounding with other musicians. And how do you find your own views fitting in? Like, I mean, do all the people in your band got the same point of view as you, or is there like friction there, or what?
No. A lot of the times, other than just than lyrically, it just sort of wouldn't come up. We'd mostly just be talking about music and gigs and stuff. But specifically that kind of crowd, I find that the music artsy type scene is a I mean, for all the chat about diversity, it's very, very, very one-track minded. I cause a lot of arguments at like festivals and that type of stuff. Not necessarily arguments, just I had a lot of fun.
Right. I mean, I know what you mean, but there might be people who listen to this who are not exactly sure what you mean. So just elaborate a little bit.
It's the, you know, man, it's like the sort of the unspoken level of virtue signaling that has to be maintained at all times. It kind of goes on at a lot of these festivals, and should anyone breach it, you kind of get that look of you ain't from round here, are you, boy, type thing. I did this morning. I got into a bit of an argument with a guy just like online who was saying like people were sort of back and forth in about immigration and the difference between legal immigration and illegal immigration. And it was quite a good discussion back and forth, blah, blah. But then this guy basically comes up with, yeah, but I have to beg the question. We all live on one planet. What's wrong with sharing it? And I'm like, we are sharing it. That's what life is. We are sharing. It's like too often the fact that we're sharing the planet is mistaken for wanting. And I coined this phrase this morning, the world is welcome, for wanting every Tom, Dick, and Sanjeev in your front room. And that's not, I don't think that's what sharing the world necessarily is, but the art world thinks differently, if it thinks at all.
If it thinks at all, yeah.
It feels a lot. And I feel a lot too, and that's part of why I'm there. But yeah, man.
Right.
Nightmare-ish.
I've noticed your work rate is like your output rate for your music and your videos and stuff is really high. And I'm amazed, like, you must spend a lot of hours per week, like producing music, writing music, recording music, da da da.
The only, like, at the minute, the album I'm working on, I'm doing with Leroy Lupton, who's my friend, brilliant producer, did like the Divide and Conquer stuff and what have you. But generally, I'd be doing it, all the albums that are on, that I've put out thus far and stuff, I've done on my own and I do at home. And it's most of the day, every day. It's kind of slowed down very recently because I don't have the software and stuff currently. But when it's on, it's on.
Yeah, I mean, I can see the amount of time that must be going into all this, you know, because I'm, you know, I produce my own videos, I do my own things. I used to be a musician. I, you know, I've got a sense of how long stuff takes, and I see you putting out music videos, and a lot of it, I presume you've edited it yourself. Do you do the video yourself?
Everything, unless it's specifically produced by Leroy, in which I'll say in the post. Yeah, everything.
Yeah, it's
For
really
better and
cool.
for worse.
And I get the sense what am I trying to say? I get the sense you'd rather put stuff out than try and get it perfect. Is that right?
Yeah, no, yeah, man, that's true, and that's one of those. There's a good and a bad to it. It's like I get out quite a lot of raw, for lack of a better word. I cringed at myself when I said that, but at the same time, it's, you know, at the expense of, there's a lot of, I don't want to say filler, but not necessarily stuff that people are going to be into. You know what I mean?
I like.
For as much as I enjoy making it, it's not that good.
I like the way you really make the most. There's definitely a stream of like a flow of creativity I can see. You make the most of relatively like simple production. Like I presume a lot of it is recorded on phones, and you know, and you do a nice job of editing and cutting between stuff and making it look like re like pretty high production value on a low budget, I presume.
Yeah, nice one, man. Yeah, I do my best. Yeah, cheers. It's
I think
cool you
it's
noticed
good.
that.
Yeah, no,
Thanks.
the rate of creativity that's flowing is really noticeable. I mean, I enjoy that much more than seeing like, you know, one song from somebody that's had a load of money spent on it and really, you know, isn't really much better, you know?
Yeah, I do. I totally do. It's the I think that's it's I look at it, it's like Prince and Michael Jackson. Like Michael Jackson was putting out, I think Bad took 5 years, which is a huge album, you know, and a great album and all that. But 5 years, man. And in those 5 years, let me see. I don't know. Printed a lot of albums.
Yeah.
Many.
Yeah.
And each one won't have stood up, but I'd rather have the wealth of work, have all the stuff to go through myself rather than just be.
What's your creative like workflow? Do you start with a groove and a rhythm or something, or do you start with lyrics and like the message? How does it work?
Completely varies. Sometimes I'll think of like a particular phrase, or even just a couple of words that I really like that I want to like make the focus of a song, or like Tom, Dick, and Sanjeev might make that into a song. Sometimes it's just sometimes even a word that I'm into, because or sometimes just like noodling around on guitar, and I'll find a groove or a rhythm. And then sort of words just come. I don't know.
Do you generally start with guitar or keys?
It'd be guitar because I don't really play keys. But it'll be guitar.
Okay.
It's complete. There's not. I don't really. I'm not too sure of the method, to be honest. It just sort of hits me from all angles. Sometimes, like I'm just walking around and I'll think of lyrics and bars and rhymes and stuff, and I'll record them on my phone because I do a lot of hip hop as well. And that's, not at the guitar at all. So
Yeah,
it can.
it's interesting to hear, because even though it's not a method, in a way that kind of is a method, because you don't put any rules or restrictions on the process, do you? It's very it's very natural and
Yeah, exactly.
organic, and whatever comes to you when you're in that mood, you record it on your phone, in a funny kind of way, that is a method, isn't it? It's a very open method.
Yeah, that's a good point.
I
The
mean,
lack of rigidity, is that a word?
yeah,
Across it's a method, yeah.
I'm the same with my movement stuff. Like if I'm practicing handstands or practicing cartwheels or just fucking around, like I don't really have, there's nothing in particular. I don't have a set of things that I do. It's just like
Yeah.
I'll move in a way, whatever I feel like practicing that day, I'll work on, if it's just like,
That's got to be the best way, has it not? I mean, what's intuition for? Like, if you're not going to listen to your body, or like, what the hell are we doing? I know it's. I think Andy once posted on Facebook something about people at the gym who are using the machines. I can't remember what you said and how you worded it, but it was awesome about the sort of rigidity of the machines they're on compared with the. Sort of the freedom and flexibility you can get from just moving what feels right. I can't remember how you put it, but
Yeah, something like
basically
that.
what you just said.
Yeah, I can't remember exactly what it was, but some people, well, a lot of people, the way I see it, they overcomplicate stuff in the gym. They think like more is better. Like they think if they do a load of complicated different movements and use resistance bands and balance balls and TRX things, and like if they think
Wearing
if
the
they
right
just,
trainers, got the right sweatbands.
they think if they just make it more and more complicated, somehow thus achieving more. And I don't think it is really. I'm more kind of meat and potatoes. I'm the kind of guy that just goes in there and just does the basic movements, and I think it actually gets a better result. And I think that
I like it.
people apply that attitude to everything in life, don't they? Like if they overcomplicate one thing, they're going to overcomplicate everything. If they think they know better in one area, they're going to think they know better in everything.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I see it as a kind of avoidance of actually doing the work. Like, actually, for example, like squatting or deadlifting. I don't know if you're into, are you into like gym stuff? I don't know.
Like very, very minimally. I don't know. Motivate me because I need to get into it.
No, I was just wondering
It's
if you had a reference for what, like squatting and
I used to go
deadlifting.
to the gym a few years ago. I know squatting and
But you know that they're
a lot of
hard
deadlifting,
work, you know. Those
similar.
it's
Yeah,
like
yeah.
they're hard work, you know. It's just lifting as much as you possibly can, and there's a temptation to avoid that and to create like complication as a way of avoiding doing the work. And I think a lot of people slip into that, if that makes sense.
Yeah, definitely. I can see that.
I'm wondering what's you're very funny, and I'm wondering what your comedic influences are. Like, were you always funny? Were you funny as a kid? Like, how did that start?
I don't know. I think so. I've always sort of been the same kind of way. So probably. I don't know, I've always been big on it entertaining and being foolish and being the class clown and all that sort of kind of thing. Making my mum and dad laugh. Yeah, I don't know. I did stand up for a little while and then I pussied out of it completely.
What was that like? I've never done that.
Awesome. It was mostly, I'd say I had about 70% success. Say I did about 10 gigs, and about seven went well, and there was about three howlers, not in the good way. When it's going well, it's as good as like a good music gig, if not better, maybe better. Because I don't know, music, I feel a little bit, there's a little bit more facade. I'm hiding behind a bit more music. You know, especially when there's moments where the band are playing and I'm literally doing nothing, just stood there looking cool. But
Right.
whereas stand up, it's like there's no, you're not stood behind the guitar, you're not stood behind the band, it's lit. So, I don't know,
Yeah.
the approval and the rejection are a lot more raw and real
I
in comedy,
see.
I think.
Yeah, interesting. Like, in order to do that, did you study it, or did you just get up there and go for it?
Oh, I'd love to say the latter. I'd love to say the latter, but I studied the pants off it. As I was in a band in called The Regulars. We were based in Manchester, and as that was coming to an end, I could smell it. Everybody could smell it. You know it. I know it. Everybody knows it. I was getting more and more into stand up and stuff, and I was watching that a lot more than I was doing and focusing in on music. And I was reading about it. I had books on it, and yeah, I went nuts with it for about a year.
Yeah. And so what was your verdict? Was it just too challenging? Like, how come you didn't pursue it that?
I don't know. I don't feel like I've have a conclusion because I don't feel like I've concluded it. I always said, oh yeah, I'm gonna come back to this when I'm a little older. I thought one of the things was. I was doing quite, oh, it's cringy now when I think about it. There was like a, obviously, right? There was like a Bill Hicks kind of essence to it. Do you know what I mean? It was political. I was trying to point stuff out and wake people up, shake people up, that kind of thing. And coming from, how old was I? A very young lad. I just don't like, I don't, it's not, people don't take to it the same as they would perhaps when I'm a little older. I don't know.
Right. How
It
old were
felt
you
strange
when?
a bit talking about politics and love and loss to a bunch of adults, and I was like 20.
Yeah, I can relate to
You know
that.
what I mean?
When I was about 19, I started getting interested in NLP and hypnotherapy and stuff, and
Yeah.
I went and got a diploma in hypnotherapy, and I decided I wanted to be a
No.
hypnotherapist. But I felt the same, like I wasn't really old enough to really understand life in order to
Right.
like deal with people and be a therapist for people that were like 20 or 30 years older than me. It really made no
Right.
sense, I didn't have enough life experience. I was too young. So, yeah, I know what you mean with that.
No, I'm like, what am I now? I'm 28 now, and like the moment, if I run into a cop or a doctor or a traffic warden, and they're 25 trying to talk to me as though they're like the, I'm like, what?
Yeah.
It feels strange. So I don't know. That's what I thought, but I don't want to just. I'm not sure. I'll have to look into that and think about it because I don't want it to become one of those. Oh yeah, I'll get round to it. I'll do that later. Things, you know, that just sits on the back burner till you burn out.
I've often wondered if there's good books about stand up. I mean, I've been curious about it myself. It was like, what's the good books to read?
The good from there's a few that are like good from an interesting perspective, but in terms of assisting you do stand up, I really don't, honestly don't think so. The best, I suppose, like advice I ever got for doing stand up was, do you know Doug Stanhope, comedian?
Yeah, I think I've heard him, yeah.
It's I emailed him once, just out of the blue, before my very first gong show or whatever it was. Just on the off chance he'd give me some pointers, and he said the best advice I can give you is to not take advice from other people on stand up because it kills your own inner voice. It'll drown out your own vision if you start trying to take advice and be like other comedians. And I thought that's really good. That's cool. And all the comedians that I'm into and I all seem to have that, I don't know, authenticity. They're very much themselves. And I suppose it's just a case of getting out, doing it, grinding it, doing it again, picking yourself up, doing it again, and, sanding away the bullshit.
That makes sense. Yeah, that makes sense. 'Cause as soon as you're managing all the different bits of advice that 50 different people have given to you, it just like it pisses on the fire, doesn't it?
And a lot of times as well, humor is like, it's specifically humor. I think it has to be organic and sort of spontaneous to really work. And that's one of the things that we plan stand up, even though a lot of it's written, is you have to make it appear spontaneous. And so, yeah, I don't, advice wouldn't help with that too much, I don't think.
Yeah, that makes sense. So, but like by the sound of it, your music is a higher priority. I mean, do you intend on going back to stand up, or is it like you just focus on the music for now?
For now, music. I do want to go back to it at some point. I'm not sure if I'm still too young or if that's the excuse that's going to kill me. But I definitely want to go back to stand up at some point. For now, music's the main thing because it's something that I know I can do. I can do it whenever I want without fail. It's right here in my room. Stand up, you've got to book a gig and get on the train.
I don't want to sound like your mum right now, but I've
Go
always
on.
thought, and I've said this to you before, I've always felt like you've got so much talent that you're kind of wasted in a way. Like I've always felt you could be famous and be on the telly and be on tour. Yeah, you're the kind of person I've always imagined, should be famous really with the stuff you say, because it's up
I've
there.
got the name for it, right?
Yeah, Dean Moroney.
Dean Moroney.
I mean, to me, the stuff you say is up there with all of them, and I've always felt like, you should be famous. That's how I've always felt.
Thanks, man. That's a wonderful compliment. I don't know. I'm torn. I don't know what to say because on one hand, I completely agree. And on the other hand, I don't want to sound like the guy I truly am.
What do you mean?
I should probably be famous. I don't know. When you look at a lot of people who are famous, when you look at the majority of people who are famous, it saddens me that people like me and you aren't a little more exposed.
Yeah. I mean, does fame interest you? Like, are you a glory seeker? 'Cause I am. Like, I don't know why, but I am. I've always wanted to be like famous and admired. But do you have that same thing?
I have a love-hate relationship, perhaps a bit more than you do, with the fact that I am a glory seeker. But there's no denying it. I'm constantly doing drawing attention to myself.
Right. When you say love hate re relationship, do you believe there's something like sort of wrong or inappropriate about that desire?
I wonder about it because I wonder sometimes the intentions, am I doing this for the love of music or because the joke's funny or because there's a truth in it, or am I doing it because, just for purely selfish, narcissistic reasons? And I think heaven is when those two overlap. When it's for you and it's for the greater good. But sometimes it can be a bit confusing.
Yeah, I
Is it
understand.
for the cause or is it for the applause?
I mean,
You know what I mean?
my personal opinion is there's nothing wrong with it, and I don't think I think there's
Now I
relatively.
get you. Oh, sorry.
And
I just
go on.
then again I think like there's an ego that has to come with that as well. Like, is it for the cause? What cause? It's not my job to wake up the world or save the world. You know, I'm not Superman. So it's, I don't know, man. I'm all over. It really is. It's quite tricky.
I'll give you my own opinion. I don't think, I think there's relatively few people who are like us in terms of we've got a very strong and deep desire to be, let's just say, famous or prominent or admired, respected, and glory seekers. And so I think that like a lot of the majority of people don't really understand that nature, and it's very easy to criticize it and condemn it and say that it's wrong or inappropriate or ego driven. And personally, I don't think there's anything wrong with it. I think it is it's more unusual, but I don't think there's anything wrong with it. That's my personal feeling.
I think you're right. I think, yeah, I don't see there is anything wrong with it.
And also, like being altruistic and
I wonder
what's
if my attitude would change if I actually was super successful, rich and famous. I wonder if I'd be going, yeah, it's great, there's nothing wrong with it. And, you know, perhaps the only reason I'm a bit more hesitant to say that is because I'm not, you know?
I know what you mean. Also, the other thing, I think giving and receiving for me is two sides of the same coin. I don't think you can really receive stuff without having provided some kind of service, you know, that warranted it. And so, like,
Yeah, definitely.
and a lot of
That's a good
people,
idea.
you know what I mean? Like, a lot of people view it as like you're either taking or you're giving. You can't do both. And I don't see it that way. I feel like the more you provide, the more you receive. And so there's no way of avoiding providing a contribution, you know?
Yeah, no, I definitely. Yeah, if the applause has to come from somewhere. And that's, you know, assuming you've fulfilled a purpose, you've pleased a bunch of people.
That's what I think anyway.
Yeah, man. No, I think that's right.
How do you consume information? Are you a reader? Are you a podcast listener? Are you a YouTube watcher?
Yeah, I'm a podcast YouTube person. I don't really read. I read articles. Not so much books. I like audio books. I find it easier to take things in that way. I can, you know, and also I can get up and move around and do other stuff, which is, I don't have the patience for a book.
Yeah, same here. I kind of find it a waste of time sitting and reading.
Yeah, that's how it feels. I feel like I've wasted an evening if I sit and read a book, which is silly, really. But
What kind of stuff do you generally listen to?
podcasts along the lines of this one, just conversations, things on. I like Free Domain Radio. I know you're into Free Domain Radio. I like Stefan. Any philosophical, political, thinky stuff. I don't really listen to music podcasts or. I was going to say I don't listen to comedy podcasts, but I do listen to Rogan.
Same. I think we're pretty similar along those lines. That's,
All right.
I think
Yeah, I
we
think
can
so.
we consume the same information, don't we?
Tell me about the yoga hags.
The yoga hags.
Yeah,
Well,
the feminist yoga hellscape you escape from.
the feminist yoga hellscape I escape from. That is a perfect way of putting it. Oh man, I'm not sure where to begin with that.
Oh, I could. It makes me laugh every time I think of it, and I picture you in there with the. It makes me laugh. The conversations, I can imagine.
What happened was, I accidentally submerged myself in the world of yoga and circus,
How did that happen?
I accidentally surrounded myself with liberals, right?
Yeah.
I'm struggling to put it into words a second. That turned out to be problematic for me. Because my nature, I'm quite a capitalist in terms of I'm very ambitious and enterprising, and I would like to be successful in the conventional sense of the word. And a lot of people, not so much yoga, they're a bit more placid, but in circus, they're very hard left, very hard left. You know, they're real social justice warriors, you know. And
everyone in the circus scene is like that. Well, I mean, obviously there'll be a few exceptions here and there, but like everyone you met.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, I think so. In the arts, I think that's generally the way. And
true.
And there's this weird reversal. There's this weird up is down is up, which I don't understand. Like, there's this kind of, there's almost like an elevation and a glorifying of failure. Like, you know, like the losers are the heroes and the heroes are the losers. Mm-hmm. There's like this upside down view, you know, the successful.
It's the mothering instinct.
What is it?
It's the mothering instinct.
What does that mean?
It's the, let's just like take care of everybody. And if people are winners and if people are out there killing it, they're no use to you. You want losers.
Yeah. Yeah, basically.
Do you know what I mean? Does that make sense?
Yeah, kind of. I mean, yeah, it does make sense.
I suppose like the capitalist right side is the more masculine, you know, the ambition, the desire to achieve and do well. And the more the feminine liberal side is the more maternal instinct to just look after and nurture.
Yeah.
And so you need, yeah, you need a fresh supply of losers.
Yeah, yeah, I think that's a good way of putting it. I think that is right. And I think it's fine. It does have its place, but
yeah. Oh,
but,
yeah, yeah, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying it's, yeah.
Yeah.
The balance, I think.
But I think they went a little too far in trying to completely extinguish, you know, the masculine sort of energy, you know, and I think both needs to be allowed to exist, and it yeah,
that seems to be where culture's at in general at the minute, doesn't it? Do you think the pendulum has swung that way, that maternal instinct side, that lefty side?
Yeah, it's very interesting to see what's going to
circus has taken over, Ben.
I mean, something's got to change, and it's going to be very interesting to see what happens, because the pendulum swung so far one way. There has to be some pushback and some, like, coming back to back down to some sensibleness, doesn't there? I hope.
Yeah, yeah. Well, yeah. That tends to be how it goes. Like the image I always like to think of is the pendulum. Like, you hold it really far one way and it swings far the other way, and then it swings a little less far, and then it eventually rests in the middle. But we seem quite far from the middle at the minute.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't want to say we're in for turmoil, but we're in for, what do they call it? Turbulence.
Yeah, I think you're right. Also, something that occurred to me, and I'm not really sure about this, I'm still trying to figure this out, but like being in kind of feminine environments, I don't think was the right place for me. I mean, because in some ways it's very alluring because it's full of girls. But then there's something fundamentally not right about a bloke hanging out in a feminine environment. It's just not right in some way. It's very emasculating. It's almost like you're, I don't know, it's almost like you're disrespecting yourself in some way. That's how it felt to me.
I can understand that. I can totally understand that.
Yeah.
I can totally understand that. Yeah, sorry. I was just thinking about that. Well, I suppose my instinct would be like many a man's instinct if I was constantly surrounded by a young, beautiful woman in a yoga studio. I'm also under the impression that you could never, ever even hint at those instincts, otherwise you'd be in trouble, right?
Yeah, exactly. There's something fucked up with it, like that. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And so you have to kind of discipline yourself and your cock over time to, I can only think to say, be less of a man.
Yeah, exactly. There's something fundamentally dishonest about it. And looking back on it now, because I don't go to yoga anymore and I don't go to dance anymore. And
you don't do any of that?
No. And I haven't figured it out. I'm still trying to figure this out. But there's something I don't like about it. Like, when I look at guys that go to yoga, like, I can understand it. Like, if you just want to stretch your hamstrings and you just got some real practical desire to go to, like, because sometimes athletes, like, there was a couple of guys that were, like, triathletes and they do, stuff, and you know, and they literally wanted to go just to stretch their hamstrings. But that's fair enough. But as a guy, like, just going just purely to be a part of that culture, like a part of that social scene, is very wappy, and I don't like it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, definitely. If I was a girl who went to yoga, and I was also sort of looking for whatever boyfriend or husband or something, I would definitely go with a rule in my head that you're not going to meet him at yoga.
Yeah. Yeah.
If I, as a woman, I wouldn't date a man at yoga.
Yeah, I understand. Yeah, I know what you mean. I agree. And yeah, for me, I had the constant, because as part of that culture, like, you know, they're all into certain things. They're into veganism, and, you know, they're into going to India and Bali to do retreat, and they're into ankle bracelets and henna tattoos, and, you know, they're all into the same stuff. You know?
It's amazing how it all links, isn't it?
Yeah, so that's fair enough. That's what they're into. But really, that's not my true nature. My hero is like Gordon Gekko. You know, I want to be some rich baller on Wall Street, or, you know, like, all my heroes are like hyper masculine people. You know, like Conor McGregor or The Rock or Mike Tyson or something. Yeah. Those are that's what naturally sort of turns me on and lights me up. That's my true nature. And I found myself in these yoga environments, and I couldn't really be myself, because all I cared about, I wanted to talk about money and just like UFC and stuff. And I'm around people that want to talk about what they had for vegan breakfast today, or, you know, just like just girly stuff. And I'm thinking, this ain't right. What am I doing? I'm in the place. This, why am I here? This ain't right for me, you know?
Yeah. I remember you briefly, your dilemma with the, I think it was the meditation stuff and the meditation people who were talking about empowerment is to be found if you living in the present.
Yeah.
And it becomes a hum rather than a hustle. And it was fun watching you go through that.
Oh man. It's, yeah, like, you know, I'm not saying those people are, all I'm saying is that environment is not right for me. And it took me a while to figure that out, you know, and
but
just in a broader sense,
fish out of water.
That feeling of not being able to be yourself, regardless what the environment is not good. You know, I think we all need to be able to feel like we're able to be ourselves, you know, that's crucial.
Yeah, it's finding the right environment, isn't it? Everyone needs to find the right environment.
Yeah.
This is a bit of a tangent, but I want to tell you about it because it's a podcast. I know a few people will hear it, and I think it's pretty awesome. Do you mind if I tell you this thing?
Yeah, of course.
They did this experiment. I can't remember. I don't know who. Scientists, right? Where they put a rat in a cage with a lever on one side of the cage that gives cocaine, and a lever on the other side of the cage that gives, like, food and nutrients and water, you know, everything they need to survive. And an isolated rat in the cage will take run to the cocaine lever until it dies.
Okay.
And not even touch the food, the water, the nutrients, because it's got nothing to live for. It's got no purpose. You see, and then you put in a bunch of other rats. Now all of a sudden he's got an environment, a community, things to feed, things to fuck, things to fight, things to live for, things to die for. And you still got the cocaine lever and the food, water, nutrient lever. It doesn't even touch the cocaine lever. None of them do. And that, I think, is amazing, because it's, for one thing, what it says about addiction is that it's the lack of a purpose. It's the lack of a role, the place in a community, a society, you know, a true meaning, things to do that matter. And the other thing I was going to say relates back to your point, but I've forgotten it. Oh yeah, about finding the right environment, You have no problems with addiction, do you, Ben? You don't drink, you don't smoke.
No, I don't. That's right. I mean, I do drink, but not. It's not a problem.
Not addictively.
No,
it's not a problem.
What about you?
Yeah, I do. I have problems with it, and I think that's what I'm on the verge of at the minute. Is I'm looking for an environment. I'm trying to find the right whether it's job, girlfriend, friends. I'm not sure. Yeah, because as much as I love music and art and comedy and all that kind of thing, I was saying it's a lot of that same kind of thinking, which I irritate and irritates me. I think that's maybe one of the reasons. I mean, it's not an excuse, but when I was at these gigs and festivals and stuff, I would just drink like crazy. And I think there's a little bit of an element of it. It's because I didn't feel like I could be myself. Do you know what I mean?
I heard Steph say something like, when you're in a big group of people, you're kind of it will like the tone of the conversation will just will level out at the common denominator. Like, do you ever find that in a group of people that the conversation just becomes dumbed down to the point where it's acceptable to everyone? And like, whereas like one on one, you can have quite a nuanced conversation, can't you? You know, and then.
They're the best conversations always.
And then,
Yeah, absolutely. And it's, oh, sorry, go on.
no, yeah, no, that's all I was saying, you know. But if there's 10 people around for dinner, you end up just talking shit, you know.
Yeah, because it's, yeah, exactly. When there's so many more potential things that could offend when there's 10 sensibilities at stake.
I don't know what the answer is, but that dynamic
Well, the
definitely
answer is,
happens.
well, I don't know, the answer probably isn't. But what I always feel when I'm in those situations, and what I often tend to do, and there's a good and evil to this. The evil is that it's like, just, hey, look at me, I want to draw the attention to myself. And the good is that I want to lift us all out of this bullshit, is to try and just say the, I don't even know what I'm saying, pull the trigger on the thing that will make everyone go, what? You know, at least it's going to start some kind of conversation, even if it's just in anti what I've just said. At least, like, it gets the ball rolling, then we're talking.
I'm imagining like it's like a grenade. You're sort of throwing a conversational grenade into the
And
group.
I've got it in my back pocket this whole time, and I'm thinking, it's like I'm sat on it, and I'm thinking, should I do this? And then, yeah, alcohol helps just do it.
Also, the other thing that
It's,
may
you know, it often works out. It's often people aren't as offended and taken aback as you expect sometimes, you know, which is
yeah,
very nice when that happens.
it's weird, isn't it? I find a lot of people, like behind closed doors, they actually agree with you. It's almost like we've got this public-facing persona that is very, we keep very safe and well, most people do anyway. Most people don't want to cause a fuss. They don't want to say anything. They don't want to be seen to have any controversial views. But then I often find if you chat to people in private, they very often actually agree with you know, a lot of your outright thoughts.
Yeah, totally. I when I was in the band Divide and Conquer, it was like quite a big band. I think it was 8 or 9 of us in the band. And whenever I was, well, not whenever, but generally speaking, when I was one on one with a band member, we were seeing eye to eye on just about everything. And then, as soon as we merged and it was all of us, I didn't feel that way at all. I couldn't get anything past.
So what happened with that then? Because I used to hear the music, and then how come it ended?
I don't know. I think it was almost like destined to be one of those short burst, short-lived things, because we were never, none of us, we met to do that band, if you will. It's not like we were friends from school or something that, you know, then formed a band, which then I think would have had more chance of holding out. I just think over time, people were getting into other things. Like, some people really weren't into it, and some people just, everyone was just into it for different reasons. We were so much on different pages. That's what initially made the band great, by the way, is that we had like a funk guy, a skull guy, a soul guy, a ska guy, a jazz guy. And then when it came together, it was like a mixture of all these different flavors. And that's also why it was a time bomb, because eventually the different dedication levels and personalities and all that were just gonna, had to do their own thing, I think.
Yeah, right. And
There's
so,
no fallout or anything like that. It was just, it's for the best.
And then, like, after that, you started producing your own stuff as a solo artist, or have you created a new band around it?
Yeah, no, I've been doing stuff as a solo artist even before that, and during it, and still doing it. I ramped it up a bit, I suppose, after the band because I had more time and just, yeah, I had to put it somewhere. But no, there's been no other bands since for me.
Right.
I don't know if I want to be honest. Everyone keeps saying, "Oh, you need to follow you when you get into the band." I don't know. I'm just not feeling it at the minute.
Yeah, fair enough. How much of your time do you actually allocate to performing versus writing? Like, are you performing every week or what?
No, at the minute, I'm kind of having a bit of a break. I haven't performed in about a month or two, a couple of months. I want to get an entirely new set together because I was getting a bit bored of it, and I want to jig it around. But typically, I'll spend probably about 90, 10, 90% recording, writing, playing at home, practicing, and 10% playing out, playing live.
Hmm. And like in terms of
But
your
when I was in the band, it was a lot more gigs. But solo, I don't know, I'm not as into it, to be honest. Like, I much prefer recording and making albums and stuff as a solo person. I much prefer that. But when it, playing live, I much prefer doing that in a band. It's well better.
What's your time horizon in terms of like some people are very much like just go with the flow one day at a time, and then some people have got like really clear long-term goals. They know exactly what they're working towards. Like, where are you on that? Do you have like clear goals?
Pretty go with quite go with the flow. I have goals, but the more day to day, week to week, I don't have specific big long term goals. I have a lot of like big long term visions. But I don't know, not specific goals.
I mean, what's your ideal scenario? Like, what would you like your life to end up like?
I would like my life to end up within a family that I don't know. Yeah, I'd like to have some kids. I'd like a wife, you know, all that stuff. I'd like to be, I don't want to be rich, but well, I wouldn't mind obviously, but I want to just, once I can get to the point where I'm not worrying about bills, and I would love to be able to get to that point of not worrying about bills by some form of connecting with other people in an entertaining way, which is either funny, helpful, useful, good, enjoyable. Be it music, art, comedy, whatever it is. For that to pay enough for me to attract a beautiful woman who'll breed with me and stay with me till I die. Something like that.
Yeah, fair enough. I mean, that's basically.
And I think that kind of, I don't know. It's hard to say, but I feel like to go back to the rat thing, I wouldn't need to drink and smoke weed and do this. Not that I need to, but I wouldn't feel the, you know, I wouldn't feel as compelled to do that stuff if I had the real shit.
Yeah, right. I was gonna say, yeah, sometimes I feel like it, being self-employed, there can be like a lack of structure, can't there? It's like everything merges into one. And like, you know, people that go to work and work 9 to 5, is there's some structure there, isn't there? When they're at work, they're working. When they're not at work, they're relaxing. And in a way, I kind of admire that, you know, because there is benefit to that, I think. You know, when they're out on the weekend, they can relax, there's nothing to worry about, they can go for a trip. And
Totally.
but when you're self-employed, it can all become one, can't it? Like there's no division. How do you feel about that?
I agree. I think it's like I think like lack of structure is a somewhere along the line kind of correlates with the lack of purpose, lack of meaning thing I was talking about. I think everyone needs a structure, and whether you create one yourself and discipline yourself and have a timetable, or whether someone else imposes one, you know, if you get a rota from a boss or whatever. I think it's important to have one. I think it's definitely harder to develop your own than it is to not.
Yeah, it's tricky that,
but
isn't it?
I think it's worth doing.
Yeah.
I sense you must have some kind of regime, do you not, Ben?
Yeah, I do. I'm pretty I do have a regime. I'm pretty ritualistic in terms of I do the same thing every day. Like I go and have breakfast,
yeah.
I go to the gym, I practice handstands, I go home again and do some admin. So and in the past, in the evenings I would do classes. So yeah, I'm pretty, but then but I've still got that thing. And this is something I've been trying to figure out recently. Like I heard Gary Vaynerchuk saying on a video, like he's got no interest in going skiing. He's got no interest in going on holiday or sitting in a beer garden or looking around a museum. You know, he just loves what he does. He loves his business. He loves doing his hustle. He loves his being Gary V thing. That's what he enjoys. That's what he does. And that's it.
Yeah.
And I found that quite refreshing because I'm the same. I've actually got no interest in going on holiday and like just like hanging out and stuff. It just doesn't.
I think Trump's that way, man.
Yeah, the
king of that way.
And yeah, I've been kind of like trying to understand that more so recently. I've been more like accepting of myself, that like that's the way I am, whereas in the past I felt a little bit torn about that because I felt like, oh, maybe, you know, maybe I should want to go and walk the dog on the weekend because that's what other people do and I want to be like, I want to connect with other people, or I should want to go to a whatever, you know, some social event or something, and really I don't give a fuck about any of that stuff is the honest answer, you know.
And why do I not go want to walk around the museum? What's wrong with me?
So yeah, I've been trying to figure that out recently and I'm starting to get more comfortable with just like embracing, you know, what I do enjoy and what I don't enjoy, and like, yeah,
right, that's cool. That's it. Yeah, so you're not like you're not much of an indulgence person.
Entertainment doesn't entertain me.
Right. that's perfect. I see it. It's like when Trump was first sort of running for president and became president and all that sort of stuff, I think it was Joe Rogan who said, or somebody on the podcast said, he's nearing the end of his life and he's a billionaire and he's got like, he could literally just sail off into the sunset with a beautiful woman and his kids and just live out his retirement, you know, do what he wants. And he's taken on the most stressful job in the world. Why would anyone do that? And like, the more I'm looking and thinking about and understanding Trump, it's like, he's in heaven right now. He doesn't want to sail off into the sunset and sit on a beach with a pina colada. He wants to do this.
Challenge.
I mean, yeah, it's just different. People are different, and that's one of the difficult things for everyone to wrap their heads around, is that individuals are distinctly different from each other. Mm. You know, people just have different interests and different temperaments. They really do.
Yeah, yeah, totally true. Yeah, I've always I remember this was a big one. I remember hearing Tony Robbins saying that progress equals happiness, and that really struck me as being true, or definitely true for me.
Yeah.
Like when you feel like you're getting somewhere in any area of life, whether it's in your career and your business or in your private life or whatever, anything. You know, there's an aliveness in that. And then, like personally, I feel like any time when I feel miserable or stuck is when I don't feel like I'm progressing, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. It's, you have to move forward. It's the old, there's no such thing as staying still, you know, and not going, like time is going to move whether you like it or not. The body's going to age, like, things are going to happen. And it's up to your intent, whether you put them into progress or decline. So I think a lot of indulgence and, you know, walking around the museum or having a glass of wine, it's all bullshit that mimics, you know, it causes the brain to mimic the same reward system that happens when you're actually progressing through life.
Yeah, that's right. And Like there was a time where I used to go to like hippie stuff. I was really in the like the alternative conscious hippie scene, like five rainbow rhythms, five rhythms, like conscious dance. You know, have you ever done that kind of stuff?
I've never done it, but I've seen it and I love it.
I mean, like, yeah, I was into it for a little
That's
bit.
Rainbow Rhythm. That was a peep show
Yeah,
sketch, right? That's
yeah,
not a
yeah.
real thing, is it?
No, that's right. It's a peep show
Right,
sketch. Yeah, but
yeah.
no, yeah, but they
Right.
do it for real. But yeah, they don't call it Rainbow Rhythm. And I remember when I got to a point where I started feeling skeptical about it, and I thought to myself, "Hang on a minute,
Hey,
you can't actually. There's no way of failing at this."
yeah, right.
Like
Yeah.
we're all here, we're all waving our arms around. There's nothing to accomplish. That like you can't win or lose. There's no satisfaction in this. Like everyone's a winner. Everyone gets a medal, you know?
That's so true. Yeah. No, I don't, yeah. Ultimate, yeah. Like, I would feel so, like, pointless and out of place and hopeless doing that, and that you just completely nailed why. Because you can't fail and you can't win.
Yeah. Yeah.
You
Like not even to
pain to wave your arms around. It's crazy.
not even for a desire to like win over other people or dominate over other people, but it's just in terms of personal challenge and personal
Yeah, there's not.
satisfaction in
You can't get better at
yeah, you can't there's no chat there's nothing to accomplish.
Well,
Yeah. And then
I
so
suppose it depends on the motivation. There's probably some pussy at Rainbow Rhythms.
what say again?
You say there's nothing to accomplish, but it depends completely on your motivation. I'm sure there's plenty of spare pussy at Rainbow Rhythms.
all the wrong kind.
Yeah, of course.
But true, true, true. But yeah, so like for me, things that you can fail at, like whether it's
Accomplishments.
like you know, like powerlifting, like you either succeed in lifting that weight or you fail, or like I mean, I'm not
Yeah.
like a big martial arts guy or anything, but you know, in a fight, you either win or you lose, don't you? You know, there's like something at stake or whatever. I think, you know, we need some resistance in life. I think if you're just freewheeling downhill, I don't know.
Yep, I completely agree. It's one of the reasons I sort of backlashed a little bit against my old, more utopian self. I don't know. I almost feel like that longing for perfect world peace, perfection, is in some ways like a bit of a subconscious. It's going to sound a bit dark, but like a longing for death, because life is and should be struggle. I don't mean that like obviously in a negative way. I mean that in a that it should be a constant progression, and that requires, as you say, resistance. And I think utopian, the notion of a utopian heroin drip, just lying there drooling all day, ideal is on the surface beautiful, but at the heart of it, evil.
Yeah, it's like an
You know what I mean?
avoidance of real life, isn't it? It's a
Yeah.
fantasy as a way of checking out of reality.
Yeah. It's, yeah.
Actually, that makes me think. That reminds me, like in terms of the world of conspiracy theories and like Free Man on the Land, that's some fucked up shit, that
I know.
is.
Yep, it is. I learned the hard way a couple of times.
Yeah. What's your journey with that? Like, what have you got to say about your experience in that world?
I wouldn't say, I can't say it was much of a journey, but it was definitely like when I first came along it, it blew my head off. And it's massively convincing. And a lot of it is true, you know. A lot of the like police will do things in real life that technically on paper they shouldn't. And so you'll go out there with your arms folded and say this to them, and they'll fucking do it anyway. And I don't know. I got it's it sells you the whole notion that there are magic spells for citizens, and there aren't. Magic spells aren't for citizens.
Yeah, for people that are listening that don't know what we're talking about, there was a certain, what do you call it, like anarchist movement that went by
Yeah.
different names. One of the names was the Free Man on the Land movement. It was people that decided that why should we have to do as we're told by the government? After all, the government is supposed to represent us and is supposed to be elected, with our consent. And so, if we don't consent to be governed, then they should have no right to impose laws on us. And
Exactly.
in theory, that's correct. But unfortunately, that's not how the world currently works. The way it works
Yeah.
is we're forced to conform to the law, whether we like it or not, and whether you can vote or not really makes no difference to that. We're under threat of imprisonment, and it's just as simple as that.
Yeah, that's true. Yes. And yeah, there's no way of free manning on the land it. Or free man on the landing it, however you would say that statement,
Yeah.
and then rolling out the right sentences in court, and they're going to go, "Oh shit, he said the magic words."
Yeah. Yeah, so there was a lot of people that kind of were desperately trying to think of a way of, like, if you say the right thing in court, if you say the right thing to the police, if you communicate the fact that you don't consent to their system as law, then they shouldn't be able to force you to do anything. And there's this whole movement that came out, and it attracts a certain kind of people, I think, that feel quite disempowered, and they're longing and craving for some shred of power or significance or control,
Yeah.
in a world where they feel very out of control. And this that idea is very addictive and alluring to people that feel disempowered. And people get totally hooked on this idea that, this idea that if you say the right stuff, then they can't force you to do anything.
Yeah, I think it came around, it sort of a bit popular around the right sort of time. It was when sort of online conspiracy stuff was really sort of first starting to bloom, like David Icke, Alex Jones, and InfoWars, and people were, starting to see, at the very least, there's more to this horrific government thing than we were reading about in the papers. And there was a lot of kind of, oh God, doom and gloom, 2012 was on the horizon. And I think people were desperate for some kind of power, some kind of way to fight back against the machine. And that's around about the time the Free Man on the Land stuff really started taking off, I think.
Yeah. Like, what was your personal story with
I
that? Like,
loved it. Do you remember commonly known as Dom?
yeah.
He was a cool guy. I loved those videos.
Yeah. There's something exciting about watching that kind of stuff, isn't there? Like,
Yeah, totally.
it's
I feel
edgy.
like he's hacked the Matrix.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
What happened to that guy? He disappeared, I think.
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, I've not seen or heard of him for years. No idea.
And
Maybe they asked him.
did you ever meet Dom?
No, I never met him. I spoke to him online quite a bit, and I was a follower of his videos and what have you.
It's quite funny because,
And
like, in those circles, it always descends into everyone accusing each other of being government informants. It doesn't matter how well it
Definitely chill.
starts, sooner or later, everyone's accusing each other of working for the FBI or something, or.
That's amazing. Yeah, everyone's a shill, a disinfo warrior, whatever.
Yeah. And Charlie, what was that guy's name? Charlie Veach.
Yeah, I remember that guy. The Love Police.
Yeah, I don't know what happened to him. He kind of went quiet in the end. I think it all fizzled out, didn't it? That it like it played itself out, and all the, I think he struggled to
Yeah,
recreate the same attention.
last I saw it, he kind of descended into just like harassing security guards in supermarkets and stuff.
Yeah.
It got a bit strange.
Yeah, it's funny because, like, when you receive, because he got a lot of views and a lot of notoriety, and
Yeah, well.
it's bound to be addictive, isn't it? When you're getting attention
Yeah.
and stuff. And so, I mean, I
You've got
can,
to keep it going,
yeah,
yeah.
I can understand that desire to constantly want to keep, doing whatever kind of video is going to get some views.
Of course. Yeah. It's funny though, isn't it? Yeah, absolutely. It's a lot of things. It's understandable. It's funny. It's a little bit sad. It's a lot hilarious.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
Did you ever involve yourself in any of, like, I don't know, the marches or any, like, did you ever show up at any events or anything?
I think I did. Well, yeah, I did. I went to I did a few like 10-minute documentaries on a few things.
Really?
I remember, yeah, I went to Manchester a couple of times and filmed some marches, and interviewed people and a few things like that.
Okay, I wasn't aware of that.
I can't even remember the specifics of the marches I went to. There was one outside the BBC building in Manchester for lying about 9/11. I went to that. And there was one, I think it was an anonymous march, I think, in Manchester, which is one of the, like a general, like the 2012 more right-leaning version of, what would you call it? Suppose the anti-Brexit march today, or it's everything from LGBTQ to avocado toast.
Actually, I think it was interesting. As soon as Trump appeared, like in 2015, he announced he was going to run, and all hell broke loose. You know, I mean, it felt like society had
I
suddenly
love it.
split in two. And it was weird because a lot of people in the like the alternative scene that were the convent the traditional truthers, I from my perspective, it split people into two forks in the road. There was like the people that actually agreed with Trump, and they were more the nationalists, the conservatives, and stuff, and they resonated with what Trump was saying. And then there was the more like the socialist utopia liberal kinds, and they were opposed to him. And I feel like Trump just put like a split down the middle of the traditional truth movement.
Yeah, I think you could be right. That's yeah, it was like the final nail in the coffin for that split, I think.
Yeah.
Like Trump is a guy, I love it, and I love the whole phenomena.
Yeah. Go on.
Did you see him talking on the talking to all the world leaders? I forgot what they call it. Was it a UN meeting or
Right.
a G8, G12, one of those things? And you know the one where he starts off saying, "My administration has achieved more than almost any administration in history," and he chuckle on that, and he goes, "I didn't expect that reaction, but that's okay." You've seen that clip, right?
Yeah.
Well, that's where they end the clip, like when they show it on the media, and they go, "Well, see, President Trump, you know, framing it as though he said this thing," and then they all laughed at him. And if you watch that full speech after that chuckle, he then launches into breaking down like all his successes and achievements, and he's not. It's no bullshit. It's complete sincerity, you know, righteousness. It's full confidence, and he's listing how he's literally he's doing fantastically well, and it's just silent. And they show a few shots of faces around the room, and it's awkward. And I love it. He's talking to the world leaders. He's talking to the top psychopaths of government from around the world, and he's bitch slapping them. And they're terrified, and it's mad to me that there's so many so-called like truthers or whatever you'd want to call them, what once were in 2012, are against the man and have fallen for the media hype, you know, that he's this racist, sexist, bigot, Nazi. Okay, he might be a bigot. I'll take that one. I'll take bigot.
Right.
I'm not a sexist, homophobe, Nazi.
No, yeah, it's ridiculous, isn't it? Like, for me, the topic of Trump has become like the perfect litmus test. Like, the way somebody responds to Trump is like all I need to know about them.
That's a good idea. I'm going to start using that. That's brilliant, yeah.
Because I don't even mind if people don't like him.
Whether they freak out or not.
Yeah. If they've got like something sensible to say, that's fair enough, you know. But if they go into this, you know, this thing, you know, the sexist, racist, and it's just this ridiculous, you know, these list of labels. That's all I need to know about them.
Yeah.
You know, I know.
Conversation over.
Yeah. I mean, I know I'm not going to get any sensible thoughts out of that person, and they're not, you know, they're like, maybe we could be friends, maybe they're fun to hang out with, but I know their true nature underneath, you know. And so in a way, it's the great time saver in a way, you know. It's just like, what do you think of Trump, you know? Yeah. And if you get a sensible answer, then, you know,
that's a really good, I love that. I'm going to use that. That's a great test. It's like you say, it's whether it's not that they have to say, oh yeah, I think he's great and I agree with his policies. They could say, oh no, I think he's a terrible politician and here's why, you know.
Yeah.
And then you can have a conversation, and that's great, you can have a conversation. That's real.
Yeah, that would be fair enough. But this whole, like, orange man bad thing.
Yeah. Or the worst is if you were to, you're near the end of asking the question, so what do you think about Trump? And you're already getting, you don't actually, you can't, surely you don't mean.
Yeah, it's fucked up, isn't it? It's kind of, I don't know what to say about it. I mean, it's frustrating and it's kind of tragic and sad. Like so many people don't really have their own assessment of the world. They just repeat phrases and headlines that they've seen on their newsfeed.
Yeah, and they don't want to question anything outside of it because it could shatter the whole, the worldview is so fragile because it's all built on lies anyway. That any sort of even tolerating alternative point of view is just going to completely expose how foundationless their own worldview is to begin with. So it's like it has to be completely just, oh my god, I can't even, I'm literally shaking right now. Can't even believe you brought that up. It's because to even consider that a friend or whatever would genuinely believe stuff that you don't can be problematic for some.
Yeah.
There's a guy last night I was arguing with on the war on bullshit. I posted something on the war on bullshit and he was commenting underneath saying, you don't actually believe this conspiracy bullshit, do you? Surely it's a satire. And I was like, no. Humans never conspire. No. Like, typically not the most dangerous and power hungry among us. No, they would never conspire.
Yeah.
Like, you seriously don't believe this? Because it's like, you definitely didn't click it and watch it, for one. For two, you're only saying that so that people will read your comment and assume, oh, it's conspiracy bullshit. You're trying to ward other people away from not sharing your worldview because you need to be part of a clan, a club, a gang.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, there's a deep cowardice, I think. It's like, I think people like that are terrified of saying anything that might get them socially ostracized, really. They're totally spineless. And there's something very pathetic about it, because it actually takes some courage to sort of speak up and say, you know, what you believe is correct, doesn't it? Even if it goes against the,
That's a big one, man. That social ostracization. Can't say it. You know, like we were talking about earlier, when you've got 10 people around the table, so you have to talk shit. That's why, isn't it? It's that feeling of I don't know, the inclusion, at least the temporary part of being part of a tribe.
I had to really sort of redefine what friendship was to me, because I think for me now, it's important to distinguish between who's real friends that you can properly talk to and be yourself with, as opposed to just like acquaintances, you know, people you say hello to, people that know your name, you know. I don't think I used to have that distinction. I had them both jumbled up. Like I thought that because I knew loads of people and loads of people knew me, I didn't really distinguish whether they were really proper friends or not. And that led to a lot of frustration, because, like, you know, I was never quite sure who I was relating to, you know, and like it was never clearly defined. But now I feel like I've got a much smaller group of people that are proper good quality friends, and then everyone else is acquaintances, and that's fine, but I'm just not going to expect friendship from them, you know? And I won't be disappointed when I don't get it, you know? There's a big difference.
Yeah. Yeah, there definitely is. And I've had the exact same problem. Like once upon a time, like I knew, like you say, like a lot of people. I was like, oh, I've got a lot of friends. And in some ways, my friends sort of know me a little bit as the friend who'll maybe say the thing that you shouldn't say, or who's not too bothered about fitting in necessarily. Yeah, it's, and I suppose for a while, I don't know, for a while I assumed I had no friends. I had a lot of acquaintances. But more recently, it's come clear that a lot of people who I've known for a lot of years really are true friends, because I've got a few, friends who've stuck with me through my development, as opinions have changed. Not they were friends with me when I was left leaning, and now they're not, now right leaning. You know what I mean? The ones that are still there, and we can discuss things.
Yeah, I relate to that.
They are, there's less, and it should be. You can't have 8,000 friends. You can have 8,000 Facebook. No, you can't have 8,000 Facebook friends. You can have 5,000 Facebook friends. That's the limit. But friends, actual friends, I think you could probably have about, I don't know, five.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, I agree. Yeah, real proper people that you can confide in, and yeah, and
Yeah,
can open up
yeah,
to,
yeah.
for sure.
Nothing. Oh, yeah. Absolutely nothing wrong with associates. I think you should collect associates, and that's all well and good to, get along with people and have a laugh and what have you. Yeah, but I think friendship's a bit different.
Yeah. I there was a few a few things occurred to me. Like, if someone doesn't reply the same day, are they really a
Yeah.
friend, you know?
Right. Yeah.
I mean, it sounds brutal, but
Yeah, that's a bit brutal. We might fall out.
yeah, I don't know.
Now I'm sloppy with that. To replying and tech, all that kind of stuff. It doesn't mean I hate you. I forget.
Yeah. Yeah, so where are we? I'm trying to think. Yeah, there's
Oh, we've pinballed all over the place. What
we have,
time are we
yeah.
on?
How you doing for time? Have you got other stuff to
I'm gonna have to. I am gonna have to head out fairly shortly. I'm good for a while, but if we can wrap up in 10 minutes or 5 minutes or
Yeah,
whatever.
sure. Yeah, that's fine. So what do people need to go and look at, like in terms of websites and stuff? Where can people find your music?
Oh, deanmaroney.bandcamp.com is HQ. That's where all the albums reside. That's where there's pretty much everything. YouTube.com/Maroney since 1990. So like the videos, the podcasts, the band, the this. I'm on Spotify, iTunes, all that stuff. You can stream me on there, download things. That's about it really. The War on Bullshit on Facebook. Join us. Let's what is it? Let's make a comedy of this tragedy. Let's make sense of this confusion, and let's make fun of everything.
That's nice. I like that. I just final thing. I want to pin you down, right, and get you to declare some kind of, like, I don't know, some kind of goal or something for the next 12 months or 6 months or something like that on this podcast. What's it going to be?
What do you want me to do? A goal for the next 12 months.
Yeah.
I can't narrow it down. It's a whole pattern shift. I want to move away a bit from selfishness and like the, not, I didn't by selfishness I mean isolation. I want to move away from trying to replicate the reward system in my brain with wine and weed, and I want to find a purpose and a meaning in the world, whether it's a job, whether it's comedy, whether it's whatever, and everything that comes with it. So to pin it down to a specific goal, hard, man. I don't know what to tell you.
Fair enough. I mean,
I
yes.
certainly don't want to be married in 12 months, but no, and I don't even know. I don't know. I don't know.
No, fair enough. Fair enough.
I'll tell you what, though, within the next 12 months, I'll definitely have my new album out called Language in Practice. And so far, it's the best album I've done, as I suppose it should be. Otherwise, I wouldn't be working on it. And I aim to make that. Well, as good as I possibly can.
Okay.
I encourage people to check it out because so far I'm happy with it.
Is there already tracks out or not yet?
Yeah, No Filter is on Spotify and all that, and Shut Up, the most recent one, is on YouTube and SoundCloud. Yeah.
Okay. All right then,
That's
Dean.
all I got.
Yeah.
All right, Ben.
Okay. We'll check it out. Yeah. Thanks for talking to us today.
Nice one, Ben. Thanks. It's been fun.
Cheers. Speak to you again. Bye.
See you later, man. Cheers.